the fact that a kid who's Asian, who's Korean, who's Canadian, can look on the screen and go, oh my God, he's a Star Wars fan too. He did it. Who'd have thunk it? I wouldn't have believed it. I still don't believe it.
Yeah.
A Korean-Canadian in the Star Wars universe gives hope to a lot of people that dreams do come true and that you can, this is attainable. And I think that's Star Wars in a nutshell for me.
How did it go from there to her thinking, I know a pilot we could use?
What are you doing in town? This is fantastic. What are you doing? She's, I'm shooting a show called The Mandalorian. And my jaw dropped. Like, oh my God, Deb, are you kidding me? You're working on that? I had no idea. And she said, yeah. And Dave Filoni, do you know who he is? I'm like, yes, I know who he is, please. She said, he's a big fan of Kim's Convenience. And he wants to write something for you. And I was, you know, I was like, come on, pull the other one, right? And so I pull out my phone, and of course I've got all my Star Wars cosplay on. It was, I said, have you seen what I grabbed her elbow, and everything got really dark all of a sudden, and it was just focused in on her. And I said, you do realize I have like 7 or 8 Star Wars cosplays at home that I'm working on. She said, no. So I show her the pics. She says, send them to me, text them to me. She texts them to Dave Filoni, and immediately he's like, well, he can just show up in costume. We don't need to do anything.
Saves money.
Yeah. When people say, you know, I'm writing something with you in mind, that's lovely. But you learn never to always take that with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Because the intentions are there, and that's great. But we all know this is an industry, it's a business, and it doesn't always work out that way. So I was flattered beyond all belief. I think it was just, I was even on his radar. So I'm sitting in this cockpit in full Rebel pilot gear, which is tailor-made to me. Nice redesigned helmet with beautiful custom paint job, playing a New Republic officer, and sitting in this mock-up of the Starfield, and they start making the image of the Starfield go like this, and I grab onto the side of the cockpit, because it feels like, and I know it's bolted to the ground, but it feels like I'm actually doing this and up and down. And so it's an intense feeling as an actor to be in that kind of a controlled environment. And it's a full-on simulation, but it's in high def.
For someone who has built cosplay,
mm-hmm.
loves this universe, what was it like when you first sat in that cockpit and just like took it in?
I was 5 years old again. My dad, I was 5 years old when my dad took my sister and I to see Star Wars in a movie theater. I had no idea. What, you're 5? What do you know? What's going on? And I got transported to that galaxy far, far away my entire life, watching the movies. And then in the late 1990s, them coming back with the prequels. And I was an actor at that point thinking, oh, maybe there's a shot. And then no, they've already made these movies. There's no shot. And then to finally be there and to be sitting there, I didn't want to leave. Your helmet's being painted right now. So we've got the stand in for you. And they pull out this Tupperware. And he opened it up, and I see this helmet, and I know the design. It's not Luke's helmet. It's Biggs Darklighter's helmet. And I look at it because I know the pattern. I said, is that Biggs's helmet? And said, yeah, how do you know? I said, well, because I'm a nerd. And I said, that's not real, is it? Like, is that the actor? I said, yeah, that's the actual helmet that the actor wore. And I pick it up, and his name is in there. And I put it on my head, and I start to cry. Because this is a movie, one of the first movies I remember seeing with my dad, with my sister, and I was not expecting to actually hold, and let alone wear a piece of my history on my head. And it's hard not to get swept up in that moment. And it's the realization of, oh my God, this is actually going to be happening. I'm just so grateful